Hello and welcome to the Week in Markets. I'm Paul Durrans and I'm joined by Matt Henderson, Portfolio Manager. Now, it's been a very busy week for markets and in terms of economic data. If we think about here in the UK, we've had inflation data. We've had the announcement that we'll be having a general election on the 4th of July. We've had economic data from the UK, but also globally. And we've had some important corporate results come through this week. So a lot to dig into today. If we start firstly with the UK, thinking about inflation, a couple of weeks ago we had the Bank of England meeting where they decided to not change interest rates, but there was a nod that interest rate cuts would come in the summer. I suppose that depends on the inflation data. So inflation has been trending down, but on Wednesday we got an update on that. Matt, first of all, what was the results and what were the takeaways?
Yeah, so I think key takeaway for us as an investment team really is that that disinflation theme within the UK continues to play out, where we're seeing the rate of inflation fall. So very different to what we're seeing in the US, where it's remained higher and also stickier. So headline inflation at 2.3%, marginally above the Bank of England's 2% inflation target. Yes. But what we're seeing is that core inflation's remaining a bit stickier, although that rate has fallen, but it's still higher at 3.9%.
And I suppose when we look at the details, break down that inflation basket, it's made up of goods, it's made up of services. It's really where is that stickier prices for core inflation really coming from?
Yeah, so similar to many other developed economies, we're actually seeing the stickiness remain within the services sector. So that was at 6%, which is obviously fairly high. But then when we look at goods, a completely different story, where they're actually in deflation, so that rate is negative 0.8%.
And so I think it's worth making the point that in April, which was the measurement period we're talking about, is that you typically get annual price resets coming through, and so you can typically get a bit of volatility within the data for April. So we'll get the next one in next month, before the Bank of England meeting, so we'll be keeping an eye out for that. I suppose sticking with the UK, we've had economic data, we've had business surveys within manufacturing and services, but we've also had retail sales data. So I suppose the data so far this year has actually been better than expected, better than the Bank of England forecasts. What did we learn from the economic data this week?
Yeah, so the retail sales data was actually slightly disappointing for the market, where we actually saw that fall 2.3%, where the market was thinking more of about a 0.2% fall. So obviously data is disappointing, but there are a few mitigating circumstances within the data. There's things like an earlier Easter, yep, which obviously you get the bank holiday associated with that and the additional spending. There's also been things like poorer weather that we're normally seeing at this this year, or at this point in the year, compared to what we've seen previously. So that's also had an influence on spending over the period. But some of the things that we are seeing that are supportive for the consumer is that actually consumer sentiment has been picking up. So two of those components that have increased the outlook for the future economic backdrop, then also personal finances are expected to improve. So although this month was slightly negative, there are reasons to be optimistic.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right to bring out the point that consumer confidence is picking up, because they're still getting higher wage growth, but inflation is coming down, so you're getting real wage growth. You've seen the minimum wages increase just short of 10% last month. You've had national insurance cuts. So the consumer does appear to be in a reasonably healthy place. I suppose if we're thinking about the economic data on the manufacturing side and the services side, what else did we learn?
Yeah, so I think what we're seeing is more of a convergence between the services sector, yeah, and manufacturing. So last month, you might remember, we talked about almost a slight stalling that we saw within manufacturing, where some of the PMIs had moved below that magic 50 point where they actually signal that they're in contraction. Well, actually, we've seen them continuing to move above 50 again for the UK. So services still remains the leader and the more robust part of the economy, but we are starting to see manufacturing once again pick up.
And that's, I suppose, a healthier environment to be in, where you're not just relying on one part of the economy to drive the economy in total. You've got both areas, which is encouraging. I suppose we can broaden that out, broaden the discussion out to thinking about European data. We've had Japan, US data, all with similar readings on both manufacturing and services. Was it a similar trend?
Yeah, very similar, where we're seeing services still remain the bedrock for most developed economies, but we're seeing that pick up within manufacturing. And I think really what we're starting to see, if we think about right to the beginning of the year, the US was the main driver of global GDP, but what we're starting to see over the past couple of months is actually places like UK, Europe, Japan, as you've mentioned, starting to pick up and increase their own growth rates. So it's not just the US-dominated global GDP picture now, we're starting to see these other regions contribute towards that.
And I suppose when we look at the subcomponents of these reports, actually, when we look at the output prices in both the UK and Europe, they continue to fall. So that should give some confidence that inflation will continue to trend lower in the months ahead, and hopefully we'll get interest rate cuts coming through in the summer. Okay, let's just finish off by thinking about corporate earnings. We've been going through corporate earnings results over the last 4 to 6 weeks. They have been coming in better than expected, but this week we had Nvidia and Marks and Spencer's, which doesn't often get their headlines. But let's start with Nvidia. Matt, who are they? What's the importance? What did they report?
Yeah, so Nvidia, quite essential within this AI theme that's been within market. So they're actually involved in the designing of some of the AI chips that are used within computers and data centers, etc., for AI tools and systems. So really at the forefront of that development. And what we've seen within their earnings is that for Q1, for both revenues and profits, better than what had been forecasted. So that's always supportive for markets. But what the market also looked at is what it talked about in terms of its future guidance. And what it's continuing to see is that demand for the chips that it produces or designs is going to continue to be strong, where that demand is actually going to outstrip the supply that they can do, because they're just seeing a broader number of sectors looking to integrate AI into their business models.
I suppose if we think about the share price has almost been exponential over the last 18 months, 2 years, but they continue to deliver. And that's why the share price went up about 10% after the results. So expectations are high, but they are delivering, which is pushing the share price up again. One company hasn't quite got the same level of growth, but Marks and Spencer's, I suppose that we can think about, you know, some important trends in terms of what's happening with the UK consumer. What were the results and what takeaways were there?
Yeah, so profits better than expected, which once again is always a good thing for the market. And they've talked about seeing 12 consecutive quarters of growth within the food and also clothing unit. So, you know, that's of positive. We're seeing UK consumer trade up within the numbers as well. Reported lower costs, positive for margins. And it's interesting looking at the different divisions, because within clothing, they've managed to push on higher costs. But in places like food, they've actually looked to take them down to increase sale volumes.
And it's really the consumer thinking, well, eating out is getting more expensive, had enough there, so let's substitute, and actually using their dine-in offer at M&S. Well, thank you, Matt, and thank you very much for watching. That's all from us today, and we'll see you next week.